Welcome to the Proactive Studios. I'm Natalie Stoberman, joined by the CEO of Tonix Pharmaceuticals, Seth Lederman. Seth, how are you doing today?
Thank you. Well, thanks for having me on.
Of course, it's a pleasure to have you on. And there are big news coming out of the company, but we're zoning in on something that has been around for a few months now, but because it's progressing and related to COVID-19, things change quickly. So with the new licensing agreement with Curia Global for monoclonal antibody treatment, where are we at with that agreement that came out in December?
Thank you, Natalie. We're excited about licensing these three monoclonal antibodies from Curia because they represent really an entirely new approach to treating or preventing COVID-19 in people who are immunocompromised. I know that for many healthy people with functioning immune systems, masks are off and people are getting back to work, travel, school. But for people who are immunocompromised, the pandemic is a long way from over. And these include the elderly, people with HIV, people who are immunocompromised by cancer, chemotherapy, or, and a very important group to us, is organ transplant recipients. What's happened is that the existing monoclonal antibodies that got emergency use authorization to treat SARS-CoV-2 have become obsolete. They've become obsolete because the virus is mutated around them. So now all four of the antibody treatments that were EUA approved have been basically either lost their EUA or are no longer recommended. There's one antibody treatment for prevention, and that is still hanging on, but the CDC has reported that about 80% of circulating isolates would be able to circumvent that treatment. So we think there's a big need for new antibody treatments and preventatives, and we're excited that these three antibodies that we've licensed may represent the next generation of these kinds of treatments.
All right. And how do we know, or how will the company know when those antibodies are able to be treated on people that that you just mentioned?
Yeah, thanks, Natalie. So one of the things that makes infectious disease straightforward is that pretty much if something works in tissue culture or works in an animal model, it should have similar activity in humans. And this is particularly the case with monoclonal antibodies. Now, monoclonal antibodies are the biggest class of drugs in the pharmaceutical industry. They're led by Humira, and they're four out of the top 10 drugs are monoclonal antibody therapeutics. So we've already been able to test these antibodies developed by Curia, and we're encouraged by their activity in cell culture. Now, one of the big differences between this technology and what's been out there before is that these antibodies originated in mice. The other antibodies, the four therapeutic antibodies and the one preventative antibody, originated in either humans or a mouse with a human immune system. So we believe that the speed with which SARS-CoV-2 has mutated to avoid the existing therapies and preventatives is a sign that when the virus mutates to avoid the human population, it also mutates to avoid or evade these kinds of antibodies. So we think that developing therapies based on mouse monoclonal antibodies has the potential to have therapies that have a more durable or long period in which they would be active.
Sounds very interesting. And having an alternative for COVID treatment is always something to have in the back pocket. And but when it comes to mitigating whether or not these monoclonal antibodies become obsolete sooner than expected, how does Tonix work to prevent that?
Well, fortunately, there's a surveillance system nationally and a NIH guidelines panel that's constantly surveying the COVID-19, the SARS-CoV-2 variants out there. And once we get into the system, we imagine that would also take place for our antibody. So the big challenge now is to get this through the regulatory process as quickly as possible. FDA and EMEA are aware that the existing therapeutics and preventatives no longer work, or the preventative is still working a bit, but they have had a meeting to discuss accelerated pathways to get new products approved. So we're paying close attention to the regulatory environment and how we can quickly get our product into patients, because this is something that's really necessary, particularly for the immunocompromised people out there.
Well, Seth, thank you very much for stopping by and letting us know how this agreement is progressing.
Thank you, Ned.
Again, the CEO of Tonix Pharmaceuticals, Seth Lederman.